Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Are you spiritually brave? That is, are you courageous in the things of God? And that means, are you willing to see things concerning yourself, how God sees you? Do you want to pray like David did when David said, God, test me and try me and see if there's any unrighteousness, anything in my life that's not pleasing to you? That's spiritual bravery. And it's only when we do that that God begins to work in a very powerful manner to bring about changes and causes us to become His very image in this world. What do I mean by that? That we become a vessel that reflects His glory. Why do I use the word image? Because I'm thinking of the book of Genesis in chapter 1. When God says that He created us to be in His image, that is, to be like Him, to live in according to that same moral, ethical justice that He wants His people to reflect. Well, sadly, when we look at where we were studying when we left off last week, we see that once again, Israel, because of idolatry, Israel, because of a selfish desire to receive what she wants rather than to receive what God wants to give Israel, what we find is that she is far removed from the purposes of God, from the power of God, from the revelation of God, and exile is on the horizon. So with that said, take out your Bible and look with me, if you would, to this 10th chapter of the book of Hosea, the 10th chapter of the book of Hosea, and we're going to begin where we left off in verse 5. Now, verse 5, this section, until we conclude chapter 10, is difficult. It is highly poetic, and one of the characteristics of Hebrew poetry is this desire to use terminology which are different but have the same meaning. So, synonyms. It also uses things in regard to gender and number and other grammatical characteristics in order to tell us we're talking poetically so that we can understand what God's trying to convey. Whenever we deal with poetry, biblically speaking, God is usually trying to reveal His innermost thoughts, His feelings to His people. So look at where we left off, verse 5. We're talking about the calves. These calves were graven images. They were objects of pagan worship. And what did we say about them? We said that these calves of Bet Aven is the house of unrighteousness or the house of iniquity. So we're speaking about a place that is far removed from God's character, a place that is going to be a recipient of the judgment of God. And therefore, it should not surprise us as we look in verse 5 that there is an element of fear. They are going to fear, and this fear is going to capture the inhabitants of where? The neighbor or the dweller of Shamron. Now, this is where the capital of Israel is located. And we see in verse 5 something very important. It says, and His people are going to mourn for Him. Now, what's this talking about? God is bringing judgment, and we've already talked about how, in a poetic way, the idols are going to flee. Now, here again, idols can't flee, but it's talking about that even they had this spiritual insight to know that no one can stand in God's judgment. And what's going to happen? Well, God is bringing about purification, but the people here aren't wanting purification. They are grieving the fact that their idolatrous time is coming to an end. God is going to do so with judgment. And here's the key that we have to ask ourselves. How are you going to respond to the judgment of God? Some people, they get angry. They feel that God doesn't love them. They are not wanting to look at themselves as God sees them. They just become frustrated with the fact that God's judgment, his lack of blessing, is characterizing their life, their existence, and they get angry and they move further away from God. That's a very foolish thing to do. That's a very immature thing to do. Rather than understanding that this judgment is for the purpose of change. See, we need change, but we need godly change. So look again at verse 5. What we find here is that there's going to be great mourning of the people, but for the wrong things. Also the priests, and here again, it uses a different term for priests. Usually we find the term Kohen or Kohanim in the plural. This is the word Komer. It is a pagan terminology. And it says that these priests also, the ones who rejoice for him concerning his glory, that is the glory, this false glory of idolatry, they are also going to mourn, these ones who rejoice because of what? His departure, because he's left this place. Verse 6. Also, this one, meaning this pagan idol, it is going to be found in Ashur, taken there as a gift to the king of Erev. Now, here again, wrong response. Instead of seeing this as judgment and a call of purification, what does Israel do? Well, let's pause for a moment and remember Israel's call. God has called Israel to be the light to the nations. God has called Israel to be a godly, a spiritual influence. Remember that term, light, illuminations to the nations. And what are they doing? Instead of saying, well, wait, if we're having to leave the land, how do we talk about that land? The land of the Lord. If we are a recipient of judgment to the point that we can't carry on our lives as normal, the way we would want to carry them on because of God's judgment, maybe we need to repent. What do? Far from it. They pick up their molten images and they take them to the king, Yarev, of Assyria. And they give it to him as a gift. But here's what I want you to see. There's a couple different words in the Hebrew language for gift. One is simply the generic term matana. It's just something that was given. But there's another word for gift, and this is a spiritual word, meaning it has spiritual implications to it. And this is the word mincha, and that's exactly what we find here. So they still want to continue on. They see these calves, the workmanship of a craftsman with the hands of man. They see that as truly an object of spiritual significance rather than an object of judgment. So look again once more. They take this to the king of Assyria, Yarev. And this one is what it says, and Ephraim takes shame. And Israel will be ashamed of his counsel. For judgment will be to Shimron, just as his king, as the foam upon the face of the waters. Now, what it's talking about here, this foam, is kind of the residue. It is what the waves, great waves, produce. And what he's trying to say here is what's going to be left for the children of Israel are just this outcome, what's left over for judgment. What's missing? Well, one of the ways that biblically we can refer to the Jewish people are Am HaMivorach, which means a blessed people. That's what God calls them. He uses another term, Am Sigula, which means a treasured people. But now, what does this treasure, this blessed people have? Nothing. They're living in the residue of God's judgment. And what I want to share with you as believers in Messiah Yeshua, someone who has believed, accepted the grace of God. See, we're not called to live in such a manner. The things around us should not be the residue of judgment. That is the outcome and the effects of God's anger and condemnation. but we should be walking in what? His provision. Sadly, the Jewish people weren't at that time, and sadly, much of God's people today, a new covenant people, are not living in the things that God wants us to be receiving. We are frustrating the work of God in our life. Move on to verse 8. He says, and will be destroyed the house high places of Avon. What were these known as? The sin of Israel. Now, the high places, this term bamot in Hebrew, simply means places of pagan worship. And God has brought them to what? Destruction. That's what verse 8 says. And he calls them the high places of Avon. Avon is that word in Hebrew for unrighteousness, that which is based in iniquity, that which is the opposite of the character of God. So let me ask you, if God was to judge right now every element of iniquity, if he were to judge and bring to an end those things that do not reflect his character, would that judgment touch your life? How would it impact you? Would you be suffering of that? Or would you simply be a witness of that, of those ones around you who suffered the consequences? See, my thoughts are this. If we, as believers today, were put under that same judgment that Israel went through, how would the church respond? How would we fare in light of this? See, oftentimes we read these passages, and instead of humbling ourselves by these words, what happens? We get almost a haughty spirit of pride against Israel. And we say, wow, these people really fell short. They really messed up, rather than saying, wait, if we were judged according to that same standards, where would we be? How would God be functioning in our life? Well, let me tell you, biblically speaking, there's a time of judgment coming on the horizon. What does Paul reveal? Paul tells us that judgment will begin at the house of the Lord. And when he says that, he's not talking about the temple in Jerusalem. He's talking about where? The home of the Holy Spirit. That is you and me. So judgment begins at the house of God. That should be a sobering word for us. Well, the question is this. Israel is spoken of here as a place of building up pagan worship, a place that's going to fall under God's destruction, these high places, because they became a sin to Israel. And in the end, what's going to happen? That same expression. It says, thorns and thistles are to come up upon these altars. And what's going to be the outcome? Look at the end of verse 8. Now, verse 8 is something that we've seen in the book of Revelation and chapter 6. Now, that's important because if you remember the order of the book of Revelation, you recall that at the end of chapter 6, that sixth seal, there is an announcement of wrath. What wrath? The wrath of the Lamb. Remember how we talked about when Messiah returns, he's not coming for grace. When he comes again, he's coming for condemnation and judgment. And notice what happens here. It is only when we talk about this condemnation that there's a response from the people. What is that? Look at the end of verse 8. They will say to the mountains, just like we see in the book of Revelation at the end of chapter 6. They say to the hills, cover us, and to the hills, fall upon us. Now, the problem is this. They're not responding to the judgment of God correctly. What do they say? We want to go through it. We want to endure through it. But they're not wanting to be changed by it. They're taking cover rather than repenting. See, what did David do when God's judgment was going to be upon him? David was given a choice. He could suffer judgment in a few different means. He could fall under the judgment of man, or he could fall under the judgment of God. What did he choose? The judgment of God. Why? Mercy. Instead of saying, oh, hills fall upon us, and oh, mountains cover us up, what should have been said was, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I mean, are hills and mountains any obstacle for God? So the point I want you to see here is there is an inadequate response to the judgment of God. Today, people do that same thing. It's very popular for people just to deny God's a God of judgment anymore. They'll say, oh, that's the Old Testament God. That's not the God I believe in. I mean, God is a God of love. God loves, but God loves righteousness. And that love of righteousness causes him to hate sin. Because God loves truth, he is forced to judge deceit. And this is a world that's full of deceit and lies. So how do you respond to the judgment of God? Do you see it as a call spiritually within you to seek God's mercy, to seek his forgiveness? Or do you simply want to say, oh, I'm going to flee from it by just denying it. I'm going to take cover until it's passed, and then I'm going to go on with my own life. Verse 9. Now, verse 9 brings up an incident. This is the second time we're going to refer to it. I alluded to it very briefly. I want to elaborate a little bit now. And that is the term Gibeah. Gibeah was in the tribe of Benjamin, and we know something. We know that there was a Levite. He had a woman with him. And in the end, I don't want to go into the details, but in the end, that woman was abused in a horrible fashion. And eventually she died. And there should have been judgment upon those men that carried it out. But the leadership of Israel did not want anything to do with judgment. Why? Well, here's the problem. See, when we say, yes, God judges sin, it is a very fearful thought. Why? Because there's sin in my life. So what the people did in that time, they didn't want to judge sin because they didn't want this concept of judgment at all. They didn't want to be scrutinized by the same things that judgment scrutinizes people with. So they just wanted to ignore it. And that's why in verse 9, it says, from the days of Gibeah, Israel, you have sinned, and there you have stood. And here's the problem. He says, and it's a question that demands a negative answer. He says, the sons of Gibeah, those in Gibeah, they don't think that the war is going to overtake them, these ones of unrighteousness, of iniquity. So here's the problem. We got to be real honest with ourselves. If God has responded in this way in the past, he will do so in the future, perhaps even in our days. And in the same way that it was wrong for these people in Gibeah to think that war is not going to visit them, those sons of iniquity, it's wrong to think that we get a pass. Now here again, we're not talking about salvation. See, one of the things that you and I need to be as mature believers is not to relate everything to where we're going to spend eternity. Now obviously, having that promise of eternal life in the kingdom of God is the most comforting thing, the most blessed thing that a person can receive. It is a gift of God. That is not the sum total of our spirituality. You and I need to see that. We are called to move past that, always with that being a remembrance and a motivation for praise and worship and obedience. But the point is this. Not everything about our spiritual being is related to our salvation experience, meaning I'm going to be in the kingdom of God. Our salvation experience should mature us and deepen our walk in this present age. That's what God expects from the children of Israel. It's not enough that they are the covenant people. God wants them to live like covenant people. And therefore, look at verse 10. He says, I desired to discipline you, and I brought to you, that is, I gathered to them nations. This is judgment. He says, when I bound them in two rows. Now, some would translate that last word, to iniquity. It's really the same point. What this scripture does, it repeats what we've already talked about. This desire to double sow the land. Sometimes with two different seeds, which is a violation of Torah. Sometimes just trying to grow too much in the same place. It's that desire for what? The desire for abundance of the things of this world. Now here's a spiritual truth that I want you to learn. See, Paul says he knew the secret of being content. How? In all circumstances. When you do not know God, when you are not experiencing Him in your life, you are going to be drawn to a counterfeit. Remember what we talked about, how the enemy is always there lurking and waiting to put before us a counterfeit, so we respond to that rather than the real blessings of God. So when we are not being satisfied, we don't know that joy of being content in all circumstances. When our relationship with God is not all satisfying, what's going to happen? We're going to be just like the children of Israel. We're going to want to double sow. We're going to want to try to get more and more from this world. But when we're content with God, when we are being filled up by Him, how does God give to us? You know that verse from Luke chapter 6? It says that God gives how? Pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. We talk about Kos Yeshua, that is the cup of abundant salvation. So the point is this, we're not going to be seeking. In fact, we're going to be giving people. Why? Because we have our contentment with God. That's not this people here. So what God is saying is here, they are going to be in bondage to their two sins, or really this double sowing. That's what he's speaking about at the end of verse 10. Let's move on to verse 11. He says, Ephraim is a trained calf that loves. She loves to what? The word is douche, which is to thresh. Why is that? Now, what it's saying is that she's a learned calf. She understands things of this world. The problem is she does not use that knowledge in the proper way. What do I mean by that? Well, when an animal is used to plow, there's nothing for that animal to eat. There's just dirt. So what happens? She works, that animal works, but the only food is when it's finished. She works hard and then she receives. But when an animal threshes, well, there's the food right before. So the animal eats what he wants to eat. When he's done, then he goes a little bit longer. So it says here that Ephraim, look at verse 11, Ephraim is a trained or learned calf that loves to thresh. But he says, but I will pass over the goodness of her neck. What does that mean? The yoke. God is not going to allow that animal to just thresh. He is going to do something, he says, but I am going to ride upon Ephraim, middle of verse 11, and he is going to plow. That is Judah. And Yaakov is going to break up what? Break up the clunks of dirt. Verse 12. Sow for yourselves righteousness. Now, what he's talking about here, if we think all of life is just reaping, all of life is just being able to take whatever we want, whenever we want, that's threshing. That's how an animal would see threshing. If that's how we think, we have been misled. We need to understand that if there's going to be a harvest of righteousness, then there's got to be a sowing as well. And that's why he says, look at the text, verse 12. He says, sow for yourselves righteousness and reap according to what? Grace. So I want you to see there's a relationship here between righteousness and grace. Here's the key. When we have the desire for righteousness, God will extend His grace. What's grace? Here again, people say, it is what saves us. That's true. But let's be mature. We have been saved, hopefully. We have received the grace of God that saves. Let's move on to a mature grace. What is that? Paul talks about that. Grace leads us to obedience. Grace teaches us to deny the things of the world. Why? We don't need the things of the world. That first outcome of grace, salvation, that is man and God intimate together. That is, we're experiencing His presence in our life. And when you experience God's presence, you're satisfied. You're not going to be susceptible to the false counterfeits of Satan. You're not going to be looking for the things of this world. You're going to just take what you need, no more, for sustenance, for a simple life. You're going to use those other things for the kingdom. And that's what he's talking about here. Look again. Sow for yourselves righteousness and reap according to grace. And do what? Be willing to do something. Be willing to break up the dirt. That's what it says in the middle of verse 12, those clumps of dirt. For the time to seek the Lord, it has come. The time of what? Seek the Lord until the times of the righteous rain comes upon you. I like that. Righteous rain. Now, here again, rain, biblically speaking, is synonymous with blessing. So we want the blessings that its origin is righteousness. So unless you're sowing righteousness, you're not going to reap righteousness. Unless the desire for you is righteousness, you're not going to be someone who is going to be the recipients of grace. So God is teaching many spiritual truths in this passage of Scripture. Verse 13, he says, you have plowed evil and you're going to reap iniquity. You are going to reap or eat the fruit of falsehood or deceit, for you have trusted in the ways of what? In your ways and in the abundance of what? Men. They think because of power, they have great armies, they don't need to fear. It says, God is going to rise up a great noise among your people, and all of your fortresses are what? Going to be plundered, as the plunder of Salmon and the house of Aravel. In the day of war, when the mothers upon the children, they were torn in pieces. Now, what I want you to see is this. We don't know much about that war, but we've learned enough. It is a war of judgment. It is a war where mothers jumped upon their children to shed them, to shield them from this judgment. And both them and their children were what? It says, ripped to pieces. Great sadness. Finally, we read in the last verse, thus shall be done to you by the house of God because of the abundance of your wickedness. And in the dawn, it says, the king of Israel will be what? The king of Israel will be silent. That means be no more. It's simply a prophetic truth that God is going to uproot that empire and put them into exile. Well, once again, my time is up. Until next week, and we press on in Hosea and chapter 11.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.